So gaining business value from advanced and novel technologies, and we are surrounded by those today. They've been sold at the highest level of hype that I've ever seen in my 45 years around the industry of IT. I started in 1969 as an undergrad apprentice at Rolls-Royce, and I've been watching the industry for all those years. Don't try and calculate my age, don't worry. And the problem we have in business is working out which one is going to be the one that gives us business value. They're all different. All of our companies and organizations are different from each other. So I'm not going to be coming as a traditional academic approach. This is the answer, gentlemen and ladies, or ladies and gentlemen. This is a set of questions that will help you, I hope, decide what you need to do to get business value from all of these things. I'm going to be looking at AI in general sort of terms. I'll be looking at the questions we need to ask ourselves about blockchain, because everybody's doing blockchain these days. And of course, we've got the growth and business performance, the digital economy, we've got digital transformation, we've got change management, we've got so many things that we've got to keep an eye on. And they all interact in one or other way. But first, this is supposed to be the leadership development slot, so I'm going to have a little bit of a look at what does leadership mean. I'll then look at governance in relation to analytics, big data, AI, machine learning, blockchain, and then one that's not on here is the thing like digital transformation. And the latest that I saw last night, which means that this session, or these two sessions today, are an interesting position. A whole series of these technologies are now becoming less hype and entering reality in very, very big, very, very interesting ways. Now, as a leader, as a manager, are you managing, you know, the traditional herding sheep is a tricky job. But people and our staff are often like that. Or are you a leader? And this shows the difference, interestingly, between Middle Eastern and European shepherding, by and large. There are some areas in shepherding in Europe where this happens, but mostly it's you've got your sheepdogs with you and the herding these people, trying to get them in the right direction. Now, I found this once upon a time, and I've shown this at all the management events sessions so far. And it looks at a few of the, what I think are the more interesting standard type of leadership is aspects that you need to have. The vision, the passion, you have to walk the talk. Because if you don't walk the talk, those below you who are receiving the messages will discover and identify the hypocrisy and they will stop following. You have to be good at communication. You've got to sell your vision. You've got to sell your passion for where you want change to go. If you're going to do change management, it's no good talking to all of your staff in monotone and being just very neutral about it. You have to be passionate about the change you want to agenda. And that requires communication skills. That means you have to understand your audience. You have to understand how to connect with them. The transmission is from you to your listeners. If your listeners do not get the message, do not, as one British politician did, when after many months on the stars, going out and about talking to the British population, they really rejected his message. And he said, they're too stupid to understand what I'm talking about. Sorry, mate. You're a politician, you should know that the fault of lack of communication is with you, the communicator, not with the listeners. He could actually only have blamed himself, not the audience. And of course, if you're going to do some interesting levels of change, you have to be pretty courageous. Because probably it's been tried many times before. So why is your version going to be better than change the minds of your teams to do the right thing? Do you, top left-hand corner, tell them we're going to cross the bridge, river, and this is what we're going to do. We're going to produce a bridge. Well, they'll probably produce a bridge if it's technically feasible. And is it the best solution? At the bottom, a leader who's a weak leader will end up with a team going all sorts of directions, not having a clue. The idea is the top right one, which says, poses the challenge and then engages all of the staff, all of the team, in coming up with really bright ideas. And because it is their ideas, they will do it. Cynicism, which just negatively says, not a chance. What I'm bringing you is 45 years of experience in the industry, IT, and business change management, and so on. And academia for the last 15 years. It's a question. Because there are so many questionable things being tried, that people are trying to sell to us about advanced technology, which almost certainly will not do very well in your specific circumstances. So you need to know the question. It will help you to figure it out. As we look at some of the basic questions, some of the charts I'm going to show you are going to be very, very new to you, I suspect. As we look at the background for the last 24 years, I want to introduce to you another aspect about big data, which is being sold to us as the greatest thing to help us make decisions, to help us change our business models, to get rid of people when allied with advanced algorithms, AI, machine learning, and so on. And we're being told that all these come together with this fantastic new thing called digital disruption. Because without digital disruption, we're being told, you will die as a business. And then add to that, one of the most fantastic developments that's ever been seen is this thing called blockchain, which will change the way, not just the cryptocurrency stuff, but the way the smart contracts are going to change everything. We'll have to rewrite all of our systems into blockchain. So say, the evangelists of blockchain. And of course, like most of these sort of evangelical approaches to projects and so on, they're kind of overselling. Now, I doubt that any of you will ever have seen this chart before. This is a history of the success of IT-related projects since 1994. The one that is of interest to you is the blue line that starts on the left-hand side at 16, goes up to 39 by 2012, restarts in purple color, violet at 29%, and goes along and drops off to 23%. Now those are the proportion of IT projects over those 24 years that are successful on time to budget. The ones in blue were also delivering the contracted for functionality. Now the IT directors, the chief information officers, complained bitterly that delivering the whole agreed functionality after a five-year project with the way that globalization value. Well, the Spanish group who produced this, a consultancy on the East Coast of the USA, said, okay, right, we'll change the term, change the definition. And of course, the CIOs expected that a non-proportion of successful projects would leap. As you can see, when they backtracked parallel for 2011 and 12, there's a big drop in success rate. And last year, the latest figures I can sort of kind of extract from the system shows that we're now back down nearly to where we were in 1994. 23% of IT budgets on time to budget and delivering business value. Did anybody here realize we were so bad at IT projects? The bottom, the red one and the orange one, well, those are the ones which we know about. The few, well, now relatively few, 20% is quite few, failed budgets, projects, late over budget, and actually never got completed. The challenge ones, that green and kind of paler blue line at the top, those are the ones which kind of happen, but don't really come in on time. They're sort of typically 40% late, 40% over budget, and deliver a little bit of business value these days. And you guys hold the purse strings for the companies you work for, I guess. As CFOs and treasury and so on. This amount of failure, when you take account of the fact the world spends $3 trillion plus a year on IT-related projects and operations and activity, depending on a range of different ideas, we could be wasting $6 trillion of business value because we're using broken, fractured, fragile technology. I've been overseas in conferences around the world and talked to people in the field of IT who've been around maybe not quite as long as I have, but they've got 20, 30 years of experience. Our experience, surprisingly, is that IT systems are far, far more fragile, far more broken, far more fractured, cause far more damage and consequences when they fail than we have seen them over the last 45 years. One of the problems with much of the failed projects, as challenged and failed projects, is we are doing too many projects too quickly, or to too short time scale, and with too few resources. Danish Group said in 2002 or 2003, if you want a successful project, you take the best estimate your project team come up with, and then, not as normally happens, cut it by 30% in everything, timescale, money, and so on. They said add 150% contingency to timescale, resources, funding, everything. Apply very, very careful and thorough project management, and you might be one of those successful projects. So the first thing companies need to do, I suggest, is to look very, very much more carefully at their list of IT-related projects, choose the top, so 30% at the very most, and fund them properly. Give them as long as a project needs, not what the business thinks it wants. If the business says it thinks it wants in two-thirds of the time scale, it will be a challenge project. And by and large, we see senior execs say, yes, to the team, we know it's a challenging project, but yeah, just try your best. And you know what's going to happen? Yeah. We're seeing the cost of security failures running at around about $400 billion a year worth of economic cost with all of these break-ins and thefts of everybody's IDs. $400 roughly per set of ID that is stolen. That $6 trillion estimate should be taken in conjunction with the fact that world GDP is around about $87 trillion. Another item that one system to another, from Excel to Word, Word to, you name it, wherever. That's quite expensive as well, that's why another $6 trillion. So think about these things as you start looking at your future spend on IT projects. Data's coming from everywhere. How many of you actually realize that we probably do not know the truthfulness or accuracy of something like 80% of all of the data we have? When I first saw that, I saw that often one enterprise data is around about 10-15%. I thought, okay, ERP systems, they're okay, corporate systems are okay. And then I discovered and realized, yeah, when we implement a big new system like SAP or Oracle or whatever, we clean up all the data, we throw away 70% of all the MaaS data, regenerate everything from the first principles when we go live. What then happens is interesting. When you build that lovely new shiny system, you Paretoed the functionality down from everything we used to do to 20% of the functionality that does 80% of the workload, and threw everything else away as though the rest of the world is actually going to cooperate. It doesn't. And you will find that your staff, because they want to please both their internal and their external customers, will shoehorn data into your systems just to get the job done in the way that the customer needs it to be done. You see, your customer doesn't really respond terribly well when you want something from you and you say, computer says no. We used to have a fantastic thing in the UK with utility bills. At the end of each month, there would be a flurry, a series of letters going from black ultimately to red. You need to pay us some money because you have your bill isn't completely up to date. So you look at it, oh, £0 and 0 pence. So I don't owe you anything. No. But you have to send us a check for £0 and 0 pence, otherwise we can't clear that overdue payment. And this happens all the time. We cannot trust our data. I'm not saying don't use it, I'm saying characterize the accuracy of your data. Try hard to find out what the consequences of those inaccuracies are when you start using machines to analyze the data and make decisions on your behalf. The reason I got involved in these is because of that picture on the bottom right. That is a stationary GPS tracker sitting in my conservatory for 24 hours. I know for a fact it wasn't moving around like that. But that's what it was measuring now. Okay, most of that's within plus or minus 25 meters. That's okay. But if you're involved in retail and you're trying to send out location-based messages to your customers, 15% of all of your messages, advertising stuff, are going to go to somewhere 100 kilometers wrong, or worse. That perhaps has reputation conferences. Another problem we have, we don't really know too much about what our big data is. I don't know if any of you have been at a big meeting or in a meeting where that sort of discussion has gone on. Yeah. This one's rather fun because as far as the machine learning language systems, espressos and cappuccinos are the same, they're coffee, aren't they? They are distinct from tea or croissants. Do we recognize when our machine learning is making these sort of crazy mistakes? We don't know what our machines are learning. And this one on the bottom right is one of the key developments that came up in the last week, where we have four key developments come together in one week, which is very, very interesting. It's never happened before. Top one, the American military trying to teach their vision systems, or their Tomahawks, I believe it was, to distinguish between friendly and enemy tanks. It worked in training, it's fantastic! Until they looked at what it actually had learned. Finally, they discovered it had learned about forests and the deserts. It hadn't even recognise that there are any tanks on any of those photos at all. Or Joy Gulamwini. As you can see, quite a dark face. She couldn't get a face recognition system to recognise that she was in the picture as a human face. Painted by a study, typically 3.5% of training photos had women, black women in it, let alone her colour. So of course it didn't recognise her. Biased data. Amazon is a really interesting one. They've been working for several years to try and get an AI system to handle help with recruitment, to process job applications. Then they canned it back in January this year, but only announced it last week. It was entirely sexist. It had learned through biased data that Amazon do not recruit females for particular types of jobs. So, and then when they recognized, they started to try to play with and adjust and amend the algorithms. And of course, the way these learning systems work, you can't do that. It is not feasible. But then we all know IT teams have been told to go try and fix something, even though they say it's not feasible. But there's a lot of pressure, and they go away and play the game and eventually prove what they need in the first place. They could not get it not to be sexist. And that's because they're based on 10,000 previous applicants who were all male. Oh yeah. So they build in a lot of interesting things. Us. Now you'll be getting involved with machine learning, predictive analytics, and so on about some of the stuff you want to do. A simple, quick, nice, and easy solution to loan applications, for example, or insurance policy acceptance. Give the whole data from the last 3, 6, 12 months to one of these systems. It'll figure out for itself what the acceptance criteria are. Trouble is, this bumps straight into GDPR. You are not allowed to have a system making substantive decisions about people's future based on their data if you cannot explain it in words of one syllable, the algorithmic transparency requirement. It is slower, but much more safe to have the top right, the right-hand one, the old algorithmic approach, which says what the rules are, rule-based reasoning, because you can see exactly where it drops out. With a neural network thing, 50, 100 parameters with little weighting factors, and the upset client comes up, well, why did I fail? Weighting factors of 1% here and 2% there. Yeah, and how does it affect me? What have I done wrong? If you can't do that, you can't explain it, which you can't with that one, but you can with that one, you are transgressing GDPR. And by the way, you also need to have a frozen copy of the data and the model at the time that decision was made. Because it changes, you recalibrate the models all the time. And it's just been beginning to be discussed, that freezing of models and data. You aren't allowed to say that. Digital transformation, everyone's talking about this fantastic thing about digital transformation will change everything we do. And you need to connect stuff together with technology. Well, let me remind you, the technology, though complex, is actually trivial compared to the human aspects of doing digital transformation. Changing how human behave. And change management, which is what it's called, is something that takes a very long time. It doesn't take 18 months. It takes 5 years, 10 years. IBM found after 10 years of doing one particular change management process, the whole of their employees affected knew the technical answers, but only North America believed it. Everybody else did not believe. They hadn't changed their heart. They, you know, they got at their intellect, but not at their heart. I'll let you read this one tomorrow when you see it. Now, the rest of the bit on the blockchain is by the helped by these five or six of my students who did quite a lot of research for me earlier on this year on DLT. Essentially, blockchain is trivial. It is based on three very old technologies wrapped together in a clever new way over the last 10 years. It is an address from, an address to, and some sort of digital payload, and those of you with an account week, IBM Watson effectively delivered the death knell for Watson Cognitive. At least in terms of the hype, it is a brilliant answer. They found that Watson Oncology only works at Sloan Kettering Hospital, where it's developed. It doesn't work anywhere else in the world because of differences between how Sloan Kettering do stuff and how everybody else does it. They bought instead, would you believe it, the Red Hat Linux company for $40 billion to change their direction from cognitive systems to infrastructure, back to their roots. Which is a kind of an interesting thing, but they have spent a fortune and many, many years on Watson. And yesterday evening, John Krafcik, head of IBM Waymo, a company that is making self-driving cars, at long, long last has admitted that self-driving cars that will drive themselves under all conditions and in all places probably won't happen at all. That's a level 5 AVs. Level 3 and level 4 self-driving will need to have human interaction available in some situations for many decades to come. And last week, Uber and Lyft declared that they were getting out of the taxi business, they were getting out of the designing their own self-driving taxis, and they were setting themselves up as mobility as a platform, mobility as a service, electric scooters, electric bicycles, and so on. They're involved with the rail tickets, bus tickets, everything, a bit like the London Transport for London Oyster card. So they've broadened out. They're realizing that this hype of totally capable self-driving is now somewhere far into the future. I have never seen this sort of such a collision and a conjunction of 3, 4, 5 major technologies suddenly saying, all of our hype, the last 5, 10 years, suddenly is beginning to clatter around our ears. Let us see reality. As I said, reduce the number of projects by 2/3. Increase resources, increase your time scale, and then you have half a chance of being successful with your project. And one last thing on all of these new technologies, AI, machine learning, blockchain. What I recommend is that your spend on these technologies should not be accounted for as a project with a business return, or hopeful business return. Write off the expenditure as research and development, because you need to find out, you've got to do the work to find out whether some of these technologies will actually deliver for you and under what circumstances. Research and development, not necessarily, unless you've got very, very good evidence from existing small projects or small tests that show it will do it. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much for the insight and the different perspective on the hype. We have now a coffee break in front of us, but I don't know if you want to spend